So a lot of fields have adopted deep learning now, and a lot of state-of-the-art AI systems are based on deep neural networks. But now what is needed is, after all this madness where deep learning has taken over a lot of research areas, can we now bring in some sanity to the proceedings? Right? So there is really a need for sanity. And why I say that is that because there is this paradox of deep learning. So there is this interesting question that why does deep learning work so well despite having a high capacity? So deep neural networks have a very high capacity, which means they are susceptible to overfitting. So most of you would have done some course on machine learning. So there you know that overfitting is bad because you are just memorizing the training data and then you might not be able to do so well on the test data. And overfitting happens when your model has a high capacity. So even though deep neural networks have high capacity, why are they doing so well? And we will focus on this high capacity when we talk about the universal approximation theorem and give some arguments for why deep neural networks have such a high capacity. The other thing is they have this numerical instability, right? So we spoke about this vanishing and exploding gradients, and again we will talk about this later on in the course. So despite these training difficulties, why is it that deep neural networks perform so well? And of course they have this sharp minima, which is again could lead to overfitting. So if you look at it as an optimization problem, it is not a neat convex optimization problem. So it is a very non-convex optimization problem. So why does it still do so well? So, and it is also not very robust. So here is an example on the right hand side, the figure that you show. So the first figure is actually of a panda, and the machine is able to detect this panda with some 57% confidence, right? You have trained a machine for a lot of animal images, you have shown it a lot of animal images. At test time you show it this image, the first image that you see on the right hand side, and is able to classify this as a panda with 57% confidence. But now what I do is I add some very random noise. So that second image that you see, which has some very random pixels, if I add it to this image, I'll get a new image, right? So every pixel in this image is added to this new noise image, and I get the image which you see on the third image that you see, right? To you and me, or to any average human, this still looks like a panda. There is hardly any difference between this image and the original image. But now if you pass this to the machine, all of a sudden, instead of recognizing this as a panda, it starts to recognize it as a gibbon, and that too with 99% confidence, right? So why is it that they are not very robust? And despite this not being very robust, why are deep neural networks so successful, right? So people are interested in these questions, and people have started asking these questions, and there are no clear answers yet, but slowly and steadily there is an increasing emphasis on explainability and theoretical justifications, right? So it is not enough to say that your deep neural network works and gives you 99% accuracy. It is also good to have an explanation for why that happens. Is it that some components of the networks are really able to discriminate between certain patterns and so on? What is going on inside the network which is actually making it work so well, right? And hopefully this will bring in some sanity to the proceedings. So instead of just saying that I applied deep learning to problem X and got 90% success, it will also make some kind of more sane arguments as to why this works and what is the further promise of this and things like that, right? So that is roughly a quick historical recap of where deep learning started and where it is today, starting all the way back from advances in biology in 1871 to recent advances till 2017 and so on in deep learning, right? And here are a few URLs, so you could take a look at this for a lot of interesting applications of recurrent neural networks. There are a bunch of startups which have come up in this space, which are working on very varied and interesting problems. And here are all the references that I have used for this particular presentation. So that is where we end lecture 1, and I will see you again soon for lecture 2. Thank you.